Cafe effects became very prominent to us in this production, and I brought them on very, very early. As soon as we got Dimension on board, the first thing I did was call Guillermo del Toro, who's a very good friend of mine. And I said to Guillermo, who did the CGI work in Pan's Labyrinth? And he said, it's Cafe Effects, it's up in Santa Maria, and I'll make a call, I'll make an introduction.
I was sort of grateful because I really thought that it was a specific visual that Frank was trying to accomplish, and I thought Cafe Effects was the best choice. There was another ace in the hole, which was that their visual effects producer, Everett Burrell, used to do prosthetics and makeup effects, and Everett and I have been friends for 22 years. So the fact that he knew how I worked, I knew how he worked. There was never any competition. It was more like, we'll take these 10 shots, you take these 10 shots. It really was a collaborative effort.
When we first talked to Frank, my first feeling was it was gonna be like Shawshank, or it was gonna be like Green Mile, where it's very long, Kubrick-esque shots, beautiful, locked off. And he goes, oh no, we're not gonna do that. We're gonna shoot it handheld, very documentary style. And we're gonna do all the things that's bad for VFX. That's Steadicam, long lenses, running around, you know, very, very intense action. So I knew that was gonna be a challenge right off the bat.
The biggest challenge had to be the schedule, just the number of shots that we were going to attempt to do, the complexity of those shots, and the time that we had to do it. We knew that there was going to be a lot of creatures that would be doing a lot of interaction. Anytime you've got things that are contacting other things, that's always a lot more difficult.
It was pretty tough, you know. I mean, it was a really fast, you know, short schedule, and we had lots and lots of work to do.
While we were shooting, the artists back at Cafe Effects were doing previs and tests. So as I would get an animation, I would run over my laptop and show Frank. And Frank would get super excited because it's the first time he'd seen these things move.
And then they would deliver stuff that we could cut into the film and look at it that way. And Everett Burrell would come down and be with us on the big meetings. They would actually videotape Frank doing what we would call the puppet show.
This is loading dock turnover. Frank speaks 01.
We call him Frank Speaks. Basically, we would shoot video of the turnovers for the effect scenes.
And that's where Frank would show them what he was imagining would be there in the frame. And he would kind of use his hand to be the tentacle, and tentacle comes in and grabs and reaches out. And so that's how we really did our rough pass of discussing to them what we wanted to look like.
You know, one, something poking in, maybe just kind of feeling the lip, another one kind of just like looking around.
And it really helped the animators. And then I would digitize that scene and put those quick times on the animator's desk. And I said, well, if you have any doubt what's going on in the scene, listen to what Frank says.
This is such a very tight schedule, this movie, especially with visual effects. And we had to have the loading dock attacking Norm in a form where they could start actually creating the visual effects for us way before they were even done shooting the film.
We were talking on a weekly basis here in this conference room. We would use our program Cafe Sync. We had a same program running down there.
We basically have these quick times that communicate over the internet, and then they lock in and sync with each other, and what I'm seeing on my end, they're seeing on their end, and we can load up different shots and look at it and discuss it in real time with each other.
Oh my God, that one's disgusting.
Yes, this one here, the same one you just saw.
Wow.
He can bring up a still, draw on it, say, you know, this needs to be darker up here, and let's think arc like this.
Even the big one in the background.
Yeah.
Now,
how good
that looks.
This is fantastic.
Yeah.
Well, one of the most difficult things to do is to match, you know, a digital creature to an on-set creature, whether it's like something that's alive or the KMB creatures, which were puppets. And it's really, really tough to make them look exactly the same. So we put a lot of energy into trying to make sure that ours matched and represented the same look that Greg and his team at KMB put together.
Get it off! Get it off! Get this freaking thing off me! Get it off! Help me!
Part of the most difficult sequence was the tentacle sequence, you know, the loading dock. And we started that first, and we did previs, and then we delivered temps. And then we realized, once we delivered them, like, wow, this is gonna be really tricky, because they had so much interaction with the actors, and then all that interaction with the mist that's coming through the loading dock door.
There's a moment on the tentacles very early on where we had a directive to match the original KMB work, and Frank had just seen some nature videos of silkworms in a cave that were just fascinating looking. They're beautiful and alien at the same time. As soon as Frank saw that, he wanted us to start making some adjustments to the look.
In the rig for those creatures, we put in some dynamic tools so that the suckers would automatically move around and that the flesh would kind of move around, and when the tentacle wrapped around things or hit the ground, it would automatically flatten out.
First, we wanted to make the tentacle look wet and fleshy and kind of slimy, and that required a lot of texturing work. Everything comes down to reflection of what's being surrounded.
The zipper tentacle was the one that kind of flowers open, and on that one, you can see all these little mouths in it. It has all this geometry. It was really, really heavy. Plus, we had to make so many different versions of it.
Shot at the end with the bag boy. He's holding onto the bottom of the door. He drops down, rolls over, and then gets pulled back in the mist. And Frank was lamenting the fact that he didn't shoot the whole action with the actor. So we actually had to take the plate of the stuntman dropping down and rolling over, blend that with the plate of the actor rolling over, and then getting pulled back. And that was very difficult to do. That shot haunted us to the last second.
For the parking lot shot, it was a wide shot where you see this wall of mist that comes and rolls in and overtakes all the cars in the parking lot. That shot proved to be technically challenging because one of the most difficult things to reproduce in the virtual world is atmospheric effects like that. They require lots and lots of processing power. And for those shots, we did a combination of using a fluid solver and using practical elements. So here, Tom shot some dry ice elements, and then those were comped in and augmented as little puffs of mist here and there throughout the shot.
In the market scene, the birds originally just broke in through the windows, right? And they were just kind of flying around the room. But one of the animators came up with the idea is, what if it chased a bug? What if it had a motivation?
In the bird's natural world that we already established in the story, he'd be chasing bugs to eat them, which is happening outside the market, and it's supposed to be, just the way that these birds live. And we already have bugs in the market, so why not have these birds doing what they naturally do, chasing the bugs? That whole sequence now, I think, makes a lot more sense and is also a lot more terrifying.
All the physical effects stuff really helped us blend our creatures into the scenes. Everything that Daryl Pritchard did, we used in the cut. And then it was really a big part of us integrating our creatures into the shots.
I've always wanted to show the audience a before and after. It's stuff I see in the editing room all the time, but the audience doesn't get to see what we shot on the set, the crazy stuff that's there, versus what's in the final image, what's in the final effect shot. So we're gonna back to back it and actually show the audience what that looks like, what those differences are. Okay, here's the sequence as we originally shot it, as you saw it on the set. There's a guy there, Corey Pritchett, holding up a big, long extension pole with a flaming thing on it that Tom is chasing around. You can see Corey pop into the right edge of frame here. And then that transitions to a mechanical arm that Corey's dad, Daryl, mounted to the ceiling. This is sailing down the aisle on a track. It's a big flaming thing. And we tilt down to a flaming puppet provided by Greg Nicotero. Now here's the intermediate step, which is now they're adding the grayscale creature, giving us a good sense of what that might look like. Kind of badly superimposed there. But you can see how it's going to integrate with all the real flames and little bits of flaming stuff. And you can still see the mechanical arm. And coming up is the very final version of the shot where they have erased Corey, they've erased the pole, they've erased that mechanical arm, the track on the ceiling you can see up there. Anyway, here's the final shot as it appears in the movie. You can see all that gorgeous texturing has been done by the animators, by the computer folks, and the flames have been completely integrated with the creature. It looks very, very convincing. It's come a long way since that raw footage.
The bird was one of the heaviest creatures, just because it had so much detail in it.
Birds also had this, we call it subsurface scattering. That's the effect that the light goes through the skin, the blood vessels and fine details like that will be visible.
Oh. bug was another one of those creatures where, in its flying pose, its legs came down. It looked really, really menacing as it's flying around. But then when it lands on the ground, well, how does it stand? So we had to work with Greg and those guys to come up with good solutions for that. When we were first putting together the spiders and using the reference from KMB and the production sketches, we were like, how are these guys gonna move? What are they gonna look like? What are we gonna do to make them really creepy?
I was having difficulty finding really good spider walk reference, and we needed a lot of it. So I went home one night, I'm like, there have gotta be spiders in my house somewhere. And I got a camera with a macro lens, and I'm like, where the heck are the spiders in my house? And I actually found one. I just started filming them, and I got tons and tons of material, and it was just fantastic. We ended up using that to create our base cycles and a lot of the behaviors that we see in the film.
The web strands that shoot in the pharmacy were very complicated. Originally, we shot a bunch of elements in Shreveport. You know, we shot some silly string, we shot some hot glue. Frank hated all of it. So we just had to make it all CG. And one of the guys came up with a really great rig that has a sort of a almost ribbon quality. And it was exactly what Frank wanted. And he nailed it.
There's one pivotal image from the novella that always stands in everyone's head, and it's that shot at the end where the Land Cruiser is parked and the big creature sort of strides over it. I mean, it's a pivotal moment because after everything these people have been through, it just signals the fact that most likely they're done.
In the story, he only describes one leg of the thing because it is so huge. And when the car comes driving up, at first he thinks he's gonna run into a cliff. And then it moves and he realizes that it's just one leg of a giant creature that just goes up and up and up and disappears into the mist. I found that I couldn't draw just a leg. So, you know, I tried to visualize a creature that these legs could be supporting.
Initially, Frank was very interested in doing it sort of old school style. He wanted it to be a miniature shoot with a miniature Land Cruiser, and a really cool puppet creature and all this kind of stuff. So Bernie came up with a sketch that Frank just absolutely loved. And we gave it to Jeremy Aiello, who's one of our sculptors, and he sculpted the maquette. And then it got to be a point where all of a sudden people were like, well, we don't know how many shots there are gonna be. So we had several meetings in between Frank and Everett and myself. And I said, listen guys, the reality of the situation is you'll have more freedom if you shoot it digitally because you have a finite amount of money to spend on the shot. And if you decide you wanna change it and you have to set up and shoot it again, that's a whole other film shoot. Do it as a digital shot, and that way, if you scrap it or change your mind, you can go in and continue to add and modify and change things. We ended up designing the paint scheme and sending off all the reference. Everett came over and shot photos of the maquette and basically built our creature in the computer.
We also developed expression-driven muscle jiggle system to add a little of weight and detail into the muscles when Bigfoot walks, you can see the muscle actually rolling and twisting.
Some of the bird creatures are sort of flying around it as if it's so large that they nested in it. And as it moves away, they have to sort of chase it because it's walking away with their nest or whatever.
Frank wanted that to be deep in the mist. We'll barely see the silhouette, and sometimes we see the detail, but it's mostly in the silhouette behind the sun. And we just feel how big the creature is.
We just kind of like pulled together all our resources and we got these like two stunning shots just in under the wire.
The shot in the movie is amazing. I mean, it's a great shot and it has that iconic feel and that holy shit impact.
It's just what I visualized when I read the story and just imagined what this leg could have been attached to.
We really took great care to match that design almost exactly and get the feeling across.
We not only finished this movie, we put in a whole other climactic ending that I think every King fan wanted to see.
think that they did an amazing job. The work that I've seen that they've contributed to the movie is astounding.
The camaraderie that we had between Frank and all the department heads and my crew, it was great. We were a team, and it made a great result.
It's really a showcase for Cafe Effects in terms of, you know, that kind of VFX work. That's another thing without which The Mist couldn't have been made, really. Without Cafe Effects, without their commitment and their talent, I never would have been able to make this movie. And they really went the extra 9 miles. And you gotta be excited to do that. You gotta be really passionate to do that and be willing to stretch the dollar to the breaking point in order to deliver that kind of work.